1987 සිට නව්‍යකරණයෙන් ශ්‍රී ලාංකේය බැංකු ක්ෂේත්‍රයේ පෙරළියක් සිදු කළ අභිමානවත් 30 වසරක සැමරුම සම්පත් බැංකුව හෙට දින එළිය කරයි.
Making headlines tonight, GSP Plus on its way to Sri Lanka, a resolution to deny Sri Lanka the concession defeated in European Parliament.
First at 9, this is Other Derana 24/7.
Prime Minister's India visit, India ready to work with Japan on Sri Lanka's development. Excise ordinance extended to police. Court upholds police right to file excise cases. Turkey in turmoil. 9,000 police officers suspended after 1,000 civilian arrests. BCCI revenue cut. ICC chiefs pass revised financial structure lowering India's revenue share.
Good evening, this is your news at 9 and I'm Indivari Amuatha. We take a look at the top story in your headlines tonight. The resolution to deny the EU GSP Plus facility for Sri Lanka was defeated in the European Parliament in Brussels today. Deputy Foreign Minister Harsha De Silva said Sri Lanka would be able to obtain the key EU trade concession next month.
A European parliamentary group had tabled a resolution in the EU Parliament against granting the Generalised Scheme of Preferences Plus facility to Sri Lanka, citing slow progress on key issues including human rights. Today's vote in Brussels defeated the motion to deny GSP Plus to Sri Lanka, with 436 members voting against it, 119 in favour and 22 abstaining. Speaking to Other Derana from Brussels, Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs Dr. Harsha De Silva had this to say.
Now the ball moves forward. Sri Lanka should, by around the 20th of May, be able to obtain GSP Plus because it goes to the Council of Ministers on the 15th and it should be okayed by them.
In 2010, the EU suspended the preferential trade facility to Sri Lanka, citing serious breaches in human rights. The government applied to restore GSP Plus last July. The European Commission concluded that the country met GSP Plus entry criteria and proposed to restore the concession earlier this year in exchange for an improved human rights and labour record. As voting on reinstatement of GSP Plus neared, EU representatives raised concerns, citing a lack of progress in ensuring labour rights in Sri Lanka.
Indo-Sri Lanka fishermen's issue, regional terrorism and drug trafficking were high on the agenda as Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe met key figures of the Indian government. The Premier commenced his five-day tour of India on the 25th of this month.
Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe met Indian Foreign Minister Sushma Swaraj yesterday. During discussions, the Indian Foreign Minister emphasised that the MOU signed between the two countries on economic projects cooperation is a basic document based on friendship and brotherhood, and it aims to bring about benefits to people of both nations. Swaraj also highlighted that a number of possibilities are available for India to work together with Japan in the development process of Sri Lanka. Attention of the two parties was also diverted to the fishermen issue between Sri Lanka and India. The Indian Foreign Minister revealed that measures are taken by the central government and regional governments of India to prevent Indian fishermen from entering Sri Lankan waters. Accordingly, all the Indian fishermen will be directed towards the deep sea fisheries industry within the next 3 years. Indian Foreign Minister Sushma Swaraj declared that the Indian Ocean Conference will be held soon and it will be co-chaired by Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe and herself. In the meantime, Rajnath Singh, the Home Minister of India, emphasised the importance of intelligence units of the two countries working closely to eradicate regional terrorism, drug and human trafficking, as well as other illegal activities in the region. It was also deliberated during talks as to which extent the Indian expertise can be utilised to modernise the Sri Lankan police service. Indian Union Minister for Road, Transport, Highways and Shipping Nitin Gadkari also met Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe. During the meeting, the minister extended his support for the development of highways from Jaffna, Mannar, Trincomalee and Damula, Trincomalee.
25 senior attorneys were appointed as President's counsels today by President Maithripala Sirisena. The President appointed these senior attorneys according to the power vested in him under the Clause 33(2)(e) of the Constitution. President's media division stated that these President's counsels have reached eminence in the profession and have maintained high standards of conduct. Accordingly, prominent attorneys including Daya Palpula, Arya B. Rakava, J.C. Valiamuna, M.A. Sumanthiran, Mohammed Nizam Karyappa were appointed as President's counsels today. Field Marshal Sarath Fonseca affirms the prospect of taking up the responsibility to ensure essential services are uninterrupted and will be discussed with the President Maithripala Sirisena. The minister made the comment in response to questions raised by media following an event in Kalaniya today.
When the President asked me if I would take over the army, I was surprised and I said no. Then he requested that I accept the post of Chief of Defence Staff, to which I signalled with my hands that I would not like to accept it. Then there was a discussion and he requested that I take up the responsibility of ensuring uninterrupted essential services. At that moment, all the ministers urged me to accept it. I said we could discuss the matter and make a decision. I understand the requirement of the President. There is a procedure to appoint the head of the army. I will take the most appropriate decision that would benefit the country. The government has no reason to do it, but such a situation existed before. The former president, through the defense secretary, acted arbitrarily and used white vans. A similar situation will not be created once more. We gave freedom to people through good governance, but we will have to take action against those who abuse that freedom.
The Galle Magistrates Court today upheld a decision in favour of police in filing cases under the Excise Ordinance. The decision was taken following a case filed claiming that police have no rights to conduct excise raids.
The case was filed by several accused in October last year, highlighting that police have no power to conduct raids under the Excise Ordinance.
Illicit liquor traffickers and people who rely on them were under the impression that the police had no rights to conduct raids against them. This is a landmark case which proves that the raids conducted by police so far are legal.
Following the tragedy at the Meethottamulla garbage dump, the focus has shifted to the Gohagoda garbage heap in Kandy, which is identified as at risk of collapse. Accordingly, the governor of the central province, Niluka Ekanayaka, paid a visit to the site yesterday. Later, she revealed short-term measures to address the issues surrounding the garbage dump in Gohagoda, Kandy, will be taken up before the 15th of May.
The Gohagoda garbage dump has been identified as being at risk of collapse. The governor of the central province visited the site yesterday afternoon. Following the inspection, she pledged to ban the use of polythene within the central province. Later, the governor held discussions with the relevant officials regarding the matter.
We are hoping to go for a short-term solution before the 15th of May. It's clear the cabinet has arrived at a decision to provide long-term solutions to the garbage issue.
Meanwhile, senior lecturer of the Department of Geology at the University of Peradeniya, Professor Atula Senaratna, makes evident the Gohagoda dump is more of a threat to the Mahavali River than to the nearby residents.
Residents in the area should not be afraid, because even if the dump collapses, it will fall into the river. So if it collapses, the river will be affected.
Another suspect in the Kalathura prison bus shooting has been arrested. Two prison buses came under gunfire in Ethanamadla, Kalathura, on the 27th of February, killing two prison guards and five inmates, which included underworld figure Samyang. Police headquarters stated the suspect was arrested in Kinigama based on investigations conducted by the Paliyagudu Crime Division. Initial investigations revealed the 38-year-old suspect's involvement in numerous crimes, including an attempt to underworld figure Samayang's life in 2015 at the Kaduela Magistrates Court. Former President Mahinda Rajapaksa alleges popular figures of the SLFP were removed from the positions of organizer to ensure a UNP victory and not to strengthen the Sri Lanka Freedom Party. He made the assertion in a statement released today, adding the removals have split the SLFP and the party leader should be held responsible for it. The former president goes on to say the present government is a sinking ship and cannot govern effectively even with a group of SLFP parliamentarians propping them up. Elaborating on the local government elections, the former president said the government indefinitely postponed the local government elections as it does a realistic assessment of their popularity at this point. Minister of Labour and Trade Union Relations WDJ Seneviratna reveals that the government has made arrangements to provide more incentives to workforce in honour of the International Labour Day. The minister made evident the 525,000 rupees sum of compensation currently paid for injuries sustained at workplace would be increased to 1,050,000 rupees. A decision has also been taken to increase the maximum age when classifying a child from 14 to 16 years. The move is aimed at eliminating child labour. The minister also notes that maternity leave in the private sector would be revised. We take a short break. We'll be back with more news on the other side. On your business stories, President Maithripala Sirisena invites leading Malaysian entrepreneurs to explore possibilities of expanding investment and trade and to look for the potential of new trade opportunities in Sri Lanka. The president made these comments during talks with the CEO of Malaysia's petrochemical giant Petronas, Datuk Wan Zulkifli, at the presidential secretariat. The CEO of Petronas, the only Malaysian company to be listed in the Fortune 500, said he would explore the possibility of long-term business with Sri Lanka. He added there were several instances of supply of petroleum products to Sri Lanka by the Petronas, but the company is yet to enter into a long-term arrangement. President Sirisena said that the current political stability and peaceful atmosphere is conducive for foreign investments. Datuk Von Affirm said that he was highly impressed with what Sri Lanka could offer for business. The delegation will also meet ministers of petroleum and power and energy in Sri Lanka. Also making news on your business segment, Sri Lanka is planning to launch a sovereign bond issue this year, and seven lead managers, including the Chinese, have been appointed. Minister of Finance Ravi Karunanayake assured this in a media briefing held in Colombo today.
What we want to do is value addition. That's why we want to bring the Voluntary Declaration Act. We want people who keep monies outside, bring it here. It's 100% collateral-free reserve that is increased to the country. Then we want to obviously have an international sovereign bond issue, depending on how we see what the situation is. We got a very successfully inflow of syndicated loans that are there. There are certain values of almost up to about $1 billion that is coming in.
He went on to describe the contributing factors in the increase of fiscal policy.
There is two improvements. The fiscal consolidation has come to what was predicted to be 5.7. Revenues have gone up on areas not increasing taxes because VAT has not come in there. By that time, it was revenue slippages. Excise which didn't collect has come in. Inland revenues that didn't collect before or got political privileges not to pay came in. And also fiscal deficit has reduced and the consolidation is taking place. The fiscal policy, the World Bank and the IMF did accept that there is a tremendous improvement. I must also observe the fact that last year was an economically turbulent year.
Let's now take a look at how the Sri Lankan Colombo Stock Exchange traded today. And we have Achuthan Srirangan from First Capital Holdings for details from the trading floor.
Market was on a steady uptrend throughout the day to close at 6,572 points, gaining 55 points. Both volume and turnovers increased while a moderate foreign participation led to a net foreign inflow into the market. The foreign investor bought shares for 24 straight sessions, buying a net 800 million. They have snapped up to 10.4 billion for the month and 15 billion worth of stock for Y2D. The price appreciation in 123 counters led by big cap John Keels and CTC weighted heavily on the index, surpassing the effect of 39 negative contributors led by CCS.
And from international markets, Asian shares closed mixed today, tracking Wall Street losses, reflecting disappointment over the US tax plan. Japan's Nikkei average shed 0.19% and Mumbai's Sensex lost 0.34%. But Shanghai and Hong Kong saw gains. The SE composite picked up 0.36% and the Hang Seng gained almost half a percentage point. Taiwan's TSEC 50 and South Korea's KOSPI index also posted marginal gains today. Now we take a look at how the Sri Lankan rupee traded against other major currencies during today. Back with more news on the other side of this short break. Welcome back. Former Deputy Governor of Central Bank, Dr. W.A. Vijayawardena, alleges that the issue related to the central bank bond issuance was caused as a result of the lethargic behavior shown by members of the Monetary Board of the Central Bank. Appearing before the Presidential Commission of Inquiry to probe the controversial bond issue for a second day today, Dr. Vijayawardena stated that the Central Bank of Sri Lanka is bound by the responsibility to appoint officials with integrity, professionalism and strength of character in order to maintain its status quo.
The Presidential Commission of Inquiry to probe central bank bond issuance commenced today with a special announcement made by the panel members. The three panelists requested the media to carry on with their responsibility of reporting on the revelations related to the controversial bond issuance, bearing in mind that the Commission is only a fact-finding mission and not a court of law. Commencing the session, Senior State Counsel Shahida Bari, who represents the Attorney General's office, then brought the Commission's attention to the Treasury bond auction held on the 29th of March 2016. Answering her line of questions, former Deputy Governor of Central Bank Dr. W. A. Vijayawardena revealed that primary dealers for the first time had used the pump and dump scheme in relation to government securities a few days before the particular auction. He said, this had allowed primary dealers to buy treasury bonds at a lower price and sell them later at a higher price. Former Deputy Governor then alleged that perpetual treasuries had abused the intraday liquidity facility of the central bank as of the 1st of April that year by not paying the required ILF amount to the central bank. Elaborating as to what action central bank should have taken when perpetual treasuries violated the intraday liquidity facility, former governor said central bank could have cancelled the window of ILF for the company. Senior State Counsel Bari then brought the attention of the Commission to the controversial conflict of interest that occurred with Arjun Aloysius acting as the director of Perpetual Treasuries Holdings, which was an active primary dealer, while Arjuna Mahendran, his father-in-law, acted as the governor of the central bank. Dr. Vijayawardena explained that it would indeed be inappropriate if the former governor did not disclose to the Monetary Board his son-in-law's relationship to perpetual treasuries and disassociate himself from the decision-making process with regard to treasury bond issuances. As his final remarks, the former deputy governor then emphasized the importance of appointing officials with integrity, professionalism and strength of character in order to maintain the dignity of the central bank as the primary banking system of the nation.
Now ICC's chiefs have voted to pass a new financial model and governance structure, reversing the 2014 decision that handed effective control of the sport of India, England and Australia. India had been demanding a $570 million cut of ICC revenues, but will now receive $293 million across the period from 2016 to 2023. The ECB will receive $143 million. Zimbabwe will receive $94 million, and the other seven full member nations, including Sri Lanka, will receive 132 million rupees each, or rather dollars each. The changes were not passed unanimously, with India being the sole dissenter. In tennis, Maria Sharapova was made a winning start to her WTA comeback, securing a last 16 spot in the Stuttgart Open with a win against Roberta Vinci. Elsewhere in Europe, Rafael Nadal won on the court named after him to reach the last 16 in the Barcelona Open.
The former world number one, competing on a controversial wildcard, started nervously as she surrendered an early service game. After taking 15 minutes to win her first game, Sharapova found her feet and clinched the first set 7-5. She was irresistible in the second, winning 6-3 to set up a second-round clash against fellow Russian Ekaterina Makarova.
And that will do it.
Rafael Nadal, playing on the newly named Rafa Nadal court at the Real Club de Tennis, did not disappoint as he strolled to a straight sets victory against Rogério Dutra Silva. Nadal will play South African Kevin Anderson in the last 16.
And Tottenham moved to within 4 points to Premier League leaders Chelsea with a hard-fought 1-0 win at Crystal Palace last night, with Arsenal also defeating champions Leicester.
Having beaten Liverpool and Chelsea recently, Crystal Palace were disciplined and organised against their title-chasing opponents. Danish midfielder Christian Eriksen fired into the bottom corner from long range to maintain pressure on the leaders, with Spurs now within 4 points with 5 games left.
Who took off and seemed to have it covered.
Indeed he's there.
Arsenal also seemed as if they might have to settle for a draw, but Nacho Monreal's shot found the net off an unfortunate Robert Huth just 4 minutes from time. Arsenal are 4 points off fourth place with 6 games to play.
Well, a goal complete.
And in international news, Turkey's police force has suspended more than 9,000 officers, hours after over 1,000 people labelled secret imams were arrested. The officers were suspended over alleged links to the US-based Islamic preacher Fethullah Gulen, who was accused by Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan of instigating a failed coup against him in July last year. Turkish police said the mass suspension had been taken on the grounds of national security.
The suspensions followed a nationwide operation to arrest over 1,000 people with alleged ties to Gulen's movement, which Turkey blames for orchestrating a failed coup last July. There have been over 47,000 arrests and 120,000 sackings or suspensions since the coup. The latest situation has alarmed Europe, with leading European lawmakers calling for a formal halt to Turkey's bid to join the EU.
And a suspected arms depot near the Damascus airport outside the Syrian capital was hit by airstrikes last night. The Syrian opposition claims that the arms depot, 25 kilometers from Syria's capital, was controlled by Lebanese Hezbollah, and the strikes were carried out by the Israeli Air Force.
Reuters said that the depot handles a significant amount of weapons that Tehran, a major regional ally of Syrian President Bashar al-Assad, sends regularly by air. The Israeli intelligence minister Israel Katz was quoted as saying, "The incident corresponds completely with Israel's policy of action preventing Iran's smuggling of advanced weapons to Syria via the Hezbollah group." The explosions have caused huge fire and material damage, but no casualties have yet been reported.
And in another attempt to pressure North Korea to fund its nuclear and missile programs, to end its nuclear and missile programs, the United States will tighten sanctions on the reclusive state. The strategy was announced following a special media briefing for senators headed by top U.S. officials today.
U.S. President Donald Trump convened all 100 members of the Senate to a highly unusual meeting at the White House in the presence of U.S. officials including Secretary of State Rex Tillerson and Secretary of Defense James Mattis. Following the briefing, Tillerson, Mattis and Director of National Intelligence Dan Coats issued a joint statement saying, Trump's approach aims to pressure North Korea into dismantling its nuclear and ballistic missile programs by tightening economic sanctions and pursuing diplomatic measures with U.S. allies while assuring that the U.S. will remain open to negotiations.
I'll be back with your weather forecast after this break. On to your weather forecast for tomorrow now. Possibility for afternoon thundershowers is likely to enhance some extent during the next few days. Showers or thundershowers may occur at a few places in the western Sabrugama, southern, central and Uwa provinces during the afternoon. Light showers can be expected in the coastal areas extending from Colombo to Matara via Gaul during the morning hours. Let's now take a look at your city-by-city weather forecast. And that's it from your primetime news at 9. But before we go, we'd like to leave you with visuals from a few years ago of Anuradhapura, one of the nation's ancient kingdoms and a World Heritage Site, home to timeless monuments. We wish you a wonderful evening. Good night.
This is Sri Lanka's premier news channel, Other Derana, 24/7.